about him, now the whole team fucking here. I done kept it real from the jump. Living at my mama's house, we'd argue every month, nigga. I was trying to get it on my own. Working all night, traffic on the way home. And my uncle calling me like, where you at? I gave you the keys, so you bring it right back, nigga. I just think it's funny how it goes. Now I'm on the road, half a million for a show. And we started from the bottom, now we're here. Started from the bottom, now my whole team fucking here. Started from the bottom, now we're here. Started from the bottom, now the whole team here, nigga. Started from the bottom, now we're here. Started from the bottom, now the whole team fucking here. Started from the bottom, now we're here. Started from the bottom, now the whole team here, nigga.
One up on the speaker, 3, 2, 3. Better blow your mama's teeth out of you. Like I'm bigger than I spit, like I'm Nina. Wish you Merry Kwanzaa, set fire to my sneakers. 1, 2, flicker, might need some anesthesia. See me in the bleacher, but I cut up like a Nita. True, like we're bigger than I wanna spit, like a Rita. You see me, you feel me, you got me, Eureka. What you want? Everybody know what that ain't what you want. Say, I was talking bad, just for fun. Everybody talking shit and they down. Fat thighs, some trousers and a black eye. 3, 2, 3, only say what's up for the Wi-Fi. Guess I'm supposed to be grown. This how I feel, born a bone. And I did post, but I'm alone. Rich off catfish like Petco. Damn right, she stole that Bacardi. Damn right, he drive a Ferrari. God damn it, ain't even a party without you flexing that Murakami. Always late to the best. Showtime never ends. Power rate in the flesh. When it's on, man, it's gonna be back.
Like you took your braces off. Have you on your? It won't take me long. And this is a. I know more drug out, didn't need this. Ari said, no, what do you need, bitch? I brought the pen like I got penis.
Since I'm 42 though, and when we get in mode, I'ma dog it like I'm Cujo. Cut it out, spicy mommy's on the way. Cut it down, bust it down, so my
religion doesn't know. Sell it, be the one to sell you life. I don't buy it with a cellulite. He said the body unbelievable. Can't trust a big butt and a Gemini. I keep it juicy, juicy. I eat that lunch. She keep that booty, booty. She keep that pump. That natural beauty, beauty.
She was crazy, right? And I approached baby like, Ma, what's your age and type? She looked at me and said, you's a babe. I'm 18 and live a crazy life. Plus, I tell you what the 80s like. And I know what the ladies like. Need a man that's polite, listens and takes advice. I could be all three. Plus, I can lay the pipe. Come with me, come stay the night. She looked at me laughing, like, boy, your game is tight. I'm laughing back like, sure, you're right. Get in the car and don't touch nothing. Sit in the car. Either we loving or I see them all. Now we speeding up the west side, hand creeping up our left side. I'm ready to do it, ready to bone, ready for dome. 55th exit, damn, damn, already we home. Now let's get it on.
Hey, let's go.
Grand Brulee, what they gon' say? With the top down, scribble money, anything. We up till 6 in the morning. When the sunrise, we'll be on it. Boy, I got fire, I'm so live. Tell me when to go, baby, when we gon' slide. Baby, when we gon' slide.
Yo, that was crazy. Shout out to DJ Gemini Gilly. Going crazy. I know you have a microphone, Gemini Gilly. You want to say what's up to everybody?
Hey, what's up, everybody? How everybody doing? Can you guys hear me? What's up, everybody?
Yeah,
how's everybody
doing? Word. Thank you again, Gemini Gilly. That was crazy. Everybody, go show Gemini Gilly some love. Follow them on Instagram at DJ Gemini Gilly, the official workshop DJ for today. But I think it's time to kick things off for today. Welcome, everybody, to From the Ground Up Workshop. It's a generator music workshop, Motown Accelerator workshop. Today, we're going to be talking about how do you build a team, an artist team that wins. For those of you that don't know me, my name is Mag Rodriguez. I am the managing director for Generator Music. I'm currently based in Milwaukee. I have the rest of my team with me today. We have Brian and Sway. I'll let them say hi real quick if you guys are there.
How's it going, everybody? Thanks for coming.
Cool. Sway, you there? If you're not, it's all good. We can keep it rolling. Cool. I'm going to just keep it rolling for right now. You guys will meet Sway in a little bit. But again, thank you, everybody, for joining. I just want to give you guys a quick run of show of what's going to be happening today. So you guys just heard Gemini Gilly. Right after this, we're going to be jumping into a mental health check-in with the program's consultant when it comes to therapy. We'll get into that in just a moment. Then we'll have our Milwaukee artist announcement. So this year has been crazy. We've been working with a group of artists and managers in Milwaukee and in Detroit. So up first, we'll announce the Milwaukee artists. Then we'll meet Gordon Dillard, who is one of the panelists for today. Then we'll do the Detroit artist announcement. Then we'll have Mike Brinkley, and then I'll talk a little bit about the applications for 2022. So again, everybody, thank you for joining. This will be a good time. If you don't already, bring out your notepad and pull out your notes app, whatever. If you're watching at home, you're watching at your break at work, or whatever the case may be, it will be great. So without further ado, I want to introduce Ami Betty. Some of you guys have probably met Ami before if you guys have joined us at our workshops. Ami is a psychotherapist. Her company is called Aculanda Consulting. Ami leads our mental health curriculum that we do within the program. It's a 10 to 12 week program where the artists that go through the program essentially meet with Ami in a group setting. This year was beautiful. We were able to run it together with our Milwaukee artists and our Detroit artists virtually. So without further ado, I wanna introduce Ami for our mental health check-in. Hey Ami, you there?
I'm here, but it says that you stopped my video.
Oh no.
Okay, now it says you're letting me start it again.
Awesome. Hi Ami, how
are you? All right. I'm good. How are you?
I'm doing good. That set by Gemini Gilly always gets me ready to go.
Absolutely. So good. So good. And man, you guys have the most timely topic that you picked today. This is such a good topic, and it's been hitting it in so many different places, teams, right? So I'm super excited to talk about it and kind of bring in some of what I've been talking to a bunch of the artists about recently. So hopefully it'll land well. Awesome. Well, thanks so much for having me. So like I said, this is such a great topic. I was just talking to a bunch of the artists about some related content earlier this week, but building a team, I started brainstorming about what I wanted to talk about tonight. And all of a sudden I had so much material. I was like, oh my God, this could literally be a full day workshop. So y'all are just gonna get a few minutes. So you'll have to catch me another day to get the rest. So teams, right? When you think about that, when do you first start learning about teams? When we're born, we're part of a family, which is, sometimes for better, sometimes for worse. Sometimes it's functional, sometimes it's messy, and sometimes it can actually be, a harmful environment. Then we also go to school. We're in a class. Sometimes we might play sports. We have circles of friends. We live in neighborhoods, and sometimes we might even belong to a faith-based community or other types of communities. But deeply held unconscious self-belief is formed really early and is informed by all these different experiences with all these different groups of people. And it includes, those self-belief. It includes our insecurities, our vulnerabilities, our defenses. And for people who have worked with me within some of these programs, I know Mag and Brian and Sway, we've talked about these things so much. And all of those things end up coming back around those insecurities, those vulnerabilities, those defenses, but also our strengths. They all are somehow related to a sense of safety that comes from belonging, right? So then as we get older, there are these other places that we find a sense of belonging, right? Sometimes it might be a workplace, hopefully. It could be grassroots work that we do. It could be networks we belong to, social circles. And one thing that we don't always realize is that from the day that we're born, all these spaces we inhabit, they're different kinds of teams, right? So I looked up what's the definition of a team. And in the more common context, a team is defined as a group of people forming one of the sides in a game or a contest, right? But then if you look at the more philosophical or the broader context, a team is a group of people that work together towards a shared goal or a joint action. And, when you're building a team, we inevitably end up with, two people who are really good at this, or man, nobody's really good at replying to emails. So we hope that these different skills and strengths are spread out amongst the members of the team, right? Responsibility, timeliness, good communication, empathy, respect. These are ones that we hope everybody kind of has, right? But there's not always going to be proficiency in these, but they're skills that you can learn over time. You can have an intention to try and cultivate it and learn and grow. But there is a skill, and there's other skills. There's skills that don't necessarily come with a guidebook or roadmap, and one that we don't even often identify as a critical skill, especially when you're on a team, and it ends up becoming the downfall of so many teams. It's a skill that's based on our experiences from the moment we're born, and for better or worse, is connected to those deepest vulnerabilities and complexes. And that skill is how to do conflict, right? So how's it a skill, right? We have been moving towards such a polarized landscape in our culture. We see conflict all the time and it's messy. It's all around us. And so we started to see a lot of people like really knee-jerk reacting to it. Like it's labeled as something that can be unhealthy. It's an indicator of power dynamics and power struggles. It can be a harbinger of abuse, abusive behavior. It's a bringer of harm, an indicator of incompatibility with people. But the reality is that conflict is a crucial component of any relationship. And it is one of the most important ways to gain trust, compassion, and understanding. It can deepen connection and it can deepen commitment. When we have been taught that conflict ends up in things being chaotic, or conflict is something that we need to avoid and being nice is how we're supposed to be in the world, then of course we have not been taught how to use it as an opportunity for growth. Power struggles, which are rooted in our own vulnerabilities and insecurities, end up getting in the way of remembering that there is a shared goal and a shared vision. And that is why you are on the team in the first place, right? Even if the team is one that has a goal of winning, you don't want to start trying to compete against each other within the team, because that is when things tend to fall apart. I've been investing a lot of my energy recently in understanding how to build community. So many people have been trying to understand how to navigate the new awareness around behaviors that are no longer tolerated, particularly when it comes to interpersonal violence, social justice. Politics gets real messy and gets caught up in these things. Unpacking these things is uncomfortable, but if we view the messy process of building community and healing as one that can't involve conflict, then we're never going to get to the other side of this. We've all watched teams. We sit back, we're like, oh man, here we go. I'm gonna get my popcorn. We've watched teams, bands, communities, families. We watch them fall apart because people couldn't figure out how to navigate a conflict. And from the outside, it seems obvious how much people were caught in their own unhealed inner complexes and unable to realize it before it was too late. And of course, then we sit there and we judge, and we can sit there and come up with all the ways that they should have done things differently. But the reality is to start within yourself and ask yourself what conflict brings up deep inside of you. Do you fear being wrong or people thinking you made a mistake or that you're not enough or that you're incompetent? Do you worry that if you take a stand for what you believe, you will be shot down? Do you get caught in power struggles? Most of these things live within our deeper unconscious places. And starting to extend grace to yourself and to others is one of the places to start the work. And the work is not just in using your voice, it's also in being able to hear other people's voices as well. And know that a silent voice or an overly nice voice is guaranteed to be owned by a person who is allowing resentment to grow inside of them. Conflict is not destined to end up in harm. Conflict can be the most powerful way of forging connection. Deep thoughts.
Wow, that last line. Conflict can be the greatest way to, I already forgot it, but it was crazy.
Forge connection.
Forge connection. Yeah, that's real. That's amazing. Thank you so much, Ami. Yeah. This is
absolutely. Absolutely. And I just have to say, like, one of the things that's been so powerful about my involvement in the program is really helping people like learn how to be in community and to like really understand each other's ways that are such deeply ingrained ways that are uncomfortable and hard. And so there's like grace that people start to learn how to offer each other. So it's really been beautiful. Thanks for having me.
Amazing. Thank you so much, Ami. I wish we had, I wish I had a place to send everyone to get more wisdom from you.
Someday.
But thank you again. I appreciate it. I'm sure if the hundreds of people who are watching on YouTube, if you could hear them, they'll be yelling right now. So that was amazing. Thanks again.
Thank you.
So, Ami mentioned working with some artists and over the course of the program. And I want to start off by I wish I had a better intro for everyone, but I think I'm going to let their videos really do the talking. So up first, we're going to start off with the Milwaukee artists. And the first artist is an artist by the name of Danny Robello. He's the first Mexican regional artist that has gone through the program. And yeah, I'm gonna just press play.
Yo hago música porque me gusta. No lo hago para que la gente me conozca. Mi nombre es Dani Robello, soy artista mexicano. Mi estilo de música es regional mexicano y es corridos, románticas. Este programa es muy importante para Milwaukee porque los artistas de aquí no crecen mucho porque no saben de cómo manejar el negocio. Es muy bueno porque hay muchos artistas aquí en Milwaukee que están tratando de crecer y esto ayudaría a mucha gente. El programa me ha ayudado bien mucho porque cuando empecé no sabía nada de las regalías, de cómo colectar mi dinero, de cómo se trabajaba el negocio de la música. Lo que me ha ayudado más es que abrí mi cuenta de OOC y me ayudaron a empezar un proyecto que voy a lanzar próximamente. El programa llegó en un perfecto momento y 100% recomendado.
So that's Danny, guys. If you guys didn't catch it, Danny joined the program and he was 16 years old. He just turned 17. He has one song out that he released earlier this spring around the time that he was applying for the program. He has since generated over 15 million streams. And yeah, we're really excited to, you know, to be in this journey with Danny. Up next, we have Raya Rivera. Similar story to Danny. Didn't have any music out prior to joining the program. We've been helping Raya get in the studio, and I'll let her talk actually with this video.
As an artist, I stayed authentic and I stayed vulnerable, and I think that shows very much in my music. Hey, my name is Raya Rivera. I'm a jazz and R&B indie soul artist. I like to create everything from scratch. I like to get in the room with producers and build with them from the ground up and feel the energy of the other people that I'm working with. I just like to be as raw and present as possible when I'm creating music. Working with Generator, it's been really dope. I have been able to accumulate so many different resources and so many different opportunities. I have met amazing people that when I talk to them, they understand me and they really make my visions come to life. I think that has been the most fulfilling part so far. When you stay true to yourself and you stay true to your experiences and you hone them and you grow from them, it has amazing results. It's definitely helped me on my road to making my dreams come true.
So those are our artists. You guys will be learning more and hearing more about both Danny and Raya. This will be a good time, guys, to follow us on Instagram if you aren't already following us. That's Generator Music on Instagram. So make sure you guys follow us and you guys can learn more about Raya and Danny as we get closer to the rollouts of their music. Awesome. Well, thank you, everyone. We're going to move forward to our next portion. We just got Gordon on the line. And very quickly, I'm going to do a brief introduction, but I'm going to let him introduce himself. Gordon Dillard is an artist manager who currently works with some of the biggest stars in the industry. It's crazy to see every day, you know, Gordon shares it on his story, just like seeing the numbers with like Doja Cat continue to rise. Even seeing like Audrey Nuna and the amazing stuff that she's been accomplishing. But I'll without me talking too much, what's up, Gordon? How you doing, man?
It's good, man. How are you, bro? How you been, man?
I'm doing good, man. Thanks again for joining and being a part of this. We're streaming right now live on YouTube. I think we have a little bit over 100 folks watching. These Zoom calls are a little interesting because like we can't hear or interact with the audience, but yeah. We'll find ways and But before that, man, I would love for you to just like briefly introduce yourself and, you know, how you got to the point that you're at now, and then we could jump into some of the questions.
He said I'm Gordon. You know, most call me G, but yeah, I'm an artist manager. Work with Doja Cat, Rising Star Audrey Nuna, Aaron Ray, Dreezy, and a plethora of other like artists, and you know, involved in publishing and a bunch of different aspects of this of the industry. So, manager slash entrepreneur.
That's amazing, man. I remember I met you. It feels like 4 or 5 years ago through Amanda, and you were working with Amir Obi, and I'm sure you were working with other folks at the time. And I'm just curious, just from my perspective, seeing your trajectory over the last 5 years, as you look back at your, you know, last 5 to 10 years, can you pinpoint, you know, 3 major decisions that you made during that period that like really influenced your career to where you are now?
I'd say decisions I made for myself that actually led to further opportunity. I think that, I used to work for BT a while back. Like I worked for Universal, I was an intern for quite some time and turned that into a job eventually. And then the label kind of failed. So I ended up at BT, just needed a job. I wanted to stay in entertainment. Music at that time wasn't really easy to get into the label system. That system kind of difficult to get into in general, outside of interning through. But so I started working for BET. At the same time I was working for BET, I started a management company because while I was at the label, really realized that that it's great to have a job, but I wanted to be involved more in the space of every aspect of the artist's career, not just focus on just one, the music aspect of it, you know, and the creation of the music. I wanted to be involved in the marketing and the planning and execution and the touring and all that stuff. So I started a management company, I want to say it's probably like 2011 or 12. And while I had a job and, you know, I picked up The Mechanics, which was a producer duo back in the time. Like we did like Bryson Tiller Exchange, a bunch of, right. We had like in like the 4 years where we had like 80 something places and we were killing at the time. And then I had Amir Obi on the artist side of things. And, you know, he was buzzing with like, you know, Drake and stuff like that. So there was a decision I made. We were on tour with Party Next Door and we were trying to figure out money to get us out. We come back from the US side of things and I left for 2 weeks and then they offered us to come overseas. And I was like, this is the moment. Like I either have to leave my job or figure out, a way to do both. And I couldn't do both and I couldn't let him go out there by himself. We had a small team. So I left, man. I left BT and I decided at that point that this was going to be, you know, I was just going to, you know, figure it out from that point on. And so that decision was one decision and it forced me to think outside the box and really work for myself and really, you know, really go out and get it and you know, trial and error to a point where you succeed. Another choice was when, you know, I left, you know, some things, you know, you go up, you go down in this industry, you know, you're never always up. So you always got to prepare for everything. And as being an independent manager at the time and not associated with any majors or anything like that, I was dependent upon the artists and their money. And so when the money kind of declines, so does yours. And so I was offered an opportunity to come start up this company through Maverick. And Maverick Urban, and it caused me to leave New York, and so I had to make that decision. Like New York was a place where I wanted to live, and I just had that vision of like I want to stay here and capture the city and like conquer the city and all this other stuff. But so I made the decision to leave and to move to LA, and so that's where I'm at now. That was a big decision, and then right after the decision, it was another decision. And I was a smaller decision, but. I was dealing with a breakup at the time and so I was stuck in LA and I was supposed to be somewhere else. And somebody offered me to come to Miami. I was like, I don't really want to go. I was like, kind of a shitty space. I was like, you know what, maybe I should go. And I ended up going. And that was a trip that I actually met Yeti, which, he had Doja signed to him on a production deal. So that's how this whole Doja thing kind of happened. If I didn't go on that trip, that would never happen. So that was a life changing decision there too. So,
He's crazy, man.
I love him. Yeah, he's a good guy, man. Amazing guy.
So I'm just curious, where are you from originally?
So originally I'm from Oakland, man. I was born and raised in Oakland and moved to New York after my 2 years of what you call college. But I left and left college and went, not saying everybody should leave college, but it wasn't for me. Yep. And moved to New York, man, to chase a dream.
Right. And then, you know, you mentioned you were an intern for quite some time. And, you know, I think a lot of people romanticize the idea that you just like one day get there. You know, how long were you in those positions before?
It was tough even getting into that, because technically I wasn't supposed to be an intern. I wasn't in school at the time. I just, my sister just happened to work at labor and the finance department for Motown. And so I used to just go visit her. And then while I'm there, I used to just run around the label and introduce myself to people. And finally got in close to one of the guys who were doing A&R at the time. So he was like, yo, just come by all the time. Just come help me if we need help. So turn that into like a quote unquote internship. It was, you know, like about a year and a half of free work. And I was working longer hours than people that get paid for doing it. But just, you know, creating value for the people I was working with and working for, to a point where I could ask for some money. And because, you know, you create so much value, people can't afford to lose you.
Yep.
They got to pay you. So turn that into a job, a temp job. It wasn't like I wasn't technically working for the label. They didn't have to pay me insurance or anything like that. But I was making money. It was small, but it was something. It's a struggle, man. It's a system. Nothing comes easy, man. You got to figure out a way to get in and get experience. Yeah.
And then you also mentioned Yeti, you know, and the big theme of the workshop is like, how do you build an artist team that wins? You know, you're managing one of the biggest superstars in the world right now, yeah. You know, and that requires a ton of team effort. Yeah. Who's all currently involved in that project and maybe in some of the other artists that you're working with?
I mean, for Doja, we have a large team with Doja. You know, we have 10Q, which is a management company with the guy Josh and another girl, Lydia. And we partner that with Sal and Co and myself, you know, so it's a large team and everybody works across, everybody plays a role, plays a part. Yep. Josh, you know, he focuses a lot on the legal, but it helps in the management. I handle more of the day-to-day operations as far as business stuff. And Lydia is really great with some of that, as well as working, you know, with Doja on a day-to-day front. And Sal handles a lot of the heavy lifting and the team there brings organization, because you know, through marketing and you know, different avenues there. So marketing, branding, we have an in-house team, so that helps a lot too. So it is definitely a team effort that gets it across the finish line. So and we wrap that same type of team around all of our artists and to create success for them.
That's amazing. So can you dive a little bit deeper into like what role you play exactly in like a lot of these teams? You know, we could use Doja as an example, or even someone like Audrey Nuno, who's like rising. Yeah.
So it's different. So like, you know, and it's different for artists, right? So someone like Audrey, I play more of a guardian role in the process. You know, I'm there for you know, generally all the business needs. I don't really handle some of the day-to-day function of the stuff, but I mean, I'm on that too as well, but it's more of like the, you know, the heavier calls and the building of the businesses and working in conjunction and liaison with the PR and the labels and like, you know, the president of the labels and the president of the PR, like those guys and building initiatives and you know, strategic planning for the future for the artists. I work in direct with the artists too as well. So a lot of management is work with artists is working with the artists, keeping them afloat, keeping them stable, keeping them mentally in the game and stuff like that. So, you know, really good with working with the artists on that side. It's very, very much the same focus with Doja. There's just more people to do all these functions because there's, you know, smaller artists has less work, bigger artists has a lot of work. So, you know, we share responsibilities across the board to, you know, cause it's just a lot comes in, man. So that, you know, that alone is, if I was doing that by myself, I couldn't have time to do anything with anybody else. Cause it's just so much going on, you know? So that's, you know, that's some of the function.
So on the other side of that, you know, I'm curious, like from your experience with working with the artists, you know, you work with various artists in your career in different capacities. What are, like, if you can pinpoint, you know, I keep using this characteristics, I can't talk today, but like, there we go, man. Sorry, I'm thinking Spanish sometimes still. What are three that you can name from like an artist like Doja Cat? Like, what does it take on the artist side to like really take it all the way?
I mean, I see this, I see the same that she has across a lot of successful artists is with one, they know who they are. They know what, like, what they are. I want to say selling, but in a way it's a business, they are selling it, right? But they know who they are, what they are, and they don't really falter from that. Like, they don't allow people to change that. They stay true to that. I think that's really important for an artist. And to know, obviously, like, creatively what they want to do. Because for us, you know, we're not creatives, and most of us are not like super creative in the sense of, like, we don't, like, I don't build an artist's creativity. They come with that, and we build the business, you know? So it's important to know what you want to do. So when you do have a team that comes along, they know what to do with you, and how to push you. Also an artist, they gotta be hungry and they gotta want it. A lot of artists, they get in a situation, they look for situations, and they act as if those situations are really gonna lift their careers. It doesn't work like that, and it never will work like that. So, if there's artists out there that are like, hey, if I just get a great manager, I'll be across the board. Like, nah, you gotta put the work in. Like, it's a 50-50, it's a business part, it's a business relationship. Like, we do 50% of the work, and the artist still has to uphold their part of the bargain. If they drop or they fall, it all falls apart. You know what I mean? Like, we can't go do the work for them. We can create the work and we can create the opportunity, but at the end of the day, they got to finish it. And it's consistency, man. Like anything in life, if you keep at it, and even through failure, you'll eventually get it right, and you'll eventually keep it going, and it will grow, even if it grows at a small piece at a time. Eventually, it will grow into what you want it to be. It could take, people who are quick and they're obsessed with the fast pace of things, and nothing that people see ever happened overnight. It may look like that because they may have discovered it sooner, but it hasn't. Like Doja, for example, has been working for 9 years. This is a process. You know, it takes a long time to get there. Even Amir was working for a long time. All these artists, it's like, to build your career, it takes time. Nothing happens in the first album. You may strike a luck with a single, but still, that takes a lot of effort to make it into what it will be. And then it also takes a lot of effort to keep it there. And it takes a lot of consistency. So consistency is a big key across artists. You can't just get comfortable and relax because you got a record. If you have a record or you got a million streams, that doesn't mean anything. Like, you got to stay focused on the goal and you got to keep achieving that. So those are three qualities that I think artists, I mean, there's more there, but those are my favorite three for artists.
And I think you mentioned like numbers of years, like let's use artists like Doja Cat, for example. You know, I've heard just from people like Yeti before, like she's been working at this for a minute.
She's 16 years old, man. Like, and she's doing it before that. Doja turns 26 tomorrow. And she's been doing this almost 10 years now, right? And so, like, but people don't see the 10-year stretch. They just see they see when the moment happens, but they don't really understand what goes into creating that moment or how many years go into that. It's the same thing with any business. You create a business, man. You can't expect your business to make, millions of dollars off the bat. You gotta get out there and you gotta build it, and you have to scale it. And it takes time, like, I think patience is also something, if you want to add that to the list, you gotta have patience as an artist. You know what I'm saying? If you rush it and you rush what you're doing, it'll be sloppy. It'll be not what you want it to be. And eventually you just hurt yourself and you hurt your brand, and you can't get that back, man. Like, consumer trust is really important. If you lose, that trust in your consumer, man, like, it's difficult to get that back, man. That's hard,
I'm gonna ask you a question from the chat box. And guys watching, if you guys have questions, drop them on the chat. We'll have a Q&A section coming up. But I think this is a good question. And I get this question a ton when I'm working with like up and coming managers. Can one person do it all?
No, I thought so, man. Like, I'll tell you this, man, like, when I was running with Amir and running around with the mechanics, and we had all this success happening, man, I was killing myself. And I'm like, wasn't sleeping. Well, sleeping very little. That is a myth, by the way. That no sleep shit is a myth. You need sleep. You need sleep to keep going. But working hard, there are days where you work hard, but man, it was like, you literally can't do everything. And it's like, it will become a time you'll just lose your artist after a while, because it'll become a time where you, not only do you drain yourself and you can't sustain it, but you end up hurting your artist because you need help. And if you have ego and you say like, I can do it myself, I can get everything done, it's impossible. And you need partners, you need allies. And you can see any artist, and a lot of these big artists that are there, even their managers, they always collaborate with someone else eventually, you know, especially if they're coming up. There's just no way. Like, everybody collaborates with everybody at some point in time. Like, even if you look on the music creation side, now more than ever, like, people are they're collaborating as much as possible. Like, you're seeing 4, 5, 6, 7, 8 writers on songs that are creating hits, because it just is, it's like that. But as an artist manager, that it's impossible to do it by yourself. It's been like just solely by yourself. Like, you're gonna need a team to do that and to do anything. So yeah, no, I say absolutely not. You know, maybe in the beginning, but you're gonna eventually need somebody.
Definitely. So for everyone who didn't believe me, guys, y'all heard it here. You can't do it by yourself. The amount of folks and artists and managers that I hear, you know, they want to be a one-man show all the time. It's just not realistic. So I think within that same theme,
No, I was gonna say some people want to do it because it's a credit thing too. It's like I broke this artist, I did that, and it's like, that's a wash, bro. Like, you, like, that doesn't, that ego right there will ruin your business.
Real.
Straight up. Like, you know, that's pretty much it. That you just can't, you know.
Sure. So for the artists that are building like new teams, right? And yeah. Right now we're working with a ton of artists who, you know, even within the program, that are working on building their teams. What should they be looking for? You know, I think this is a constant question that we get. You know, so from your perspective, and you look at your team, you know, what would you recommend artists look for when they're building their team?
I always say first piece of artist needs is a great attorney. People sometimes they don't put enough value towards an attorney, but you realistically can't do any business without, not real business, without an attorney, without screwing yourself. You know what I mean? So you need an attorney. I'd say follow that by a manager. I would say follow that with attorney and manager, and I mean, with those two people, you can make a lot of moves. You know, you don't necessarily need to jump straight into a label, but those are two essential pieces to the puzzle. Those guys, you know. So, but I always start with an attorney. And you can look around, you can ask people, you can have people recommend it. Those are the two people off the top that I would look for if I was an artist.
Make sure. I mean, for sure. I mean, I think something that we also try to, you know, communicate with the artists is around education, right? So, you know, you're working with artists at the highest level right now. How educated are those artists that you're working with right now when it comes to publishing, you know, and all aspects of their career? Even when working with an attorney, do they know what to ask for, or do they depend on you and the team to, like, help cover those things?
Well, I mean, obviously they depend on us to have that information, but it's also our job to share that information, and to share that information across the entire team. It only hurts the team if we hoard information, you know what I mean? So I know there are some artists that are really heavy on the information and the knowledge, and they study this. And I think those artists are really dope, and you know, it helps them out, and they know what they're talking about when they have conversations with their attorney. Like, they can, you know, there's a lot of value in information. I remember one time I had a conversation with Puff one day, and he was just like, yo, like, he said, knowledge is power. And he said, and he was like, this is actually why I went to BET, actually. He was like, you want to learn everything about the industry so that nobody can tell you shit about, you know, anything. He's like, you can walk in a TV house, you can walk in, you know, a publishing house, you can walk in anywhere and you have the information. And I think that goes for everybody. I think that should go for the artist too. But when an artist like gets as big, like an artist like Doja, she relies on her team to make sure that she has the information. And, you know, we sit down and we explain this stuff to her, you know, and it's important because eventually she sees everything. She pays attention very much, you know? So if down the road, there's a part that we didn't explain and it runs into her and she doesn't know it, that's going to be on us because, you know, we didn't explain it to her fully and give her detail on the beginning. So it's really important that the artist in an early stage, if you're a younger artist, you should soak up as much as this industry as possible. You should understand exactly what you're doing. You should look at deals, deal points, what's a good deal versus a bad deal. all these things, because at the end of the day, you are putting your trust in other people's hands, and it's smart to know what you're getting into, you know, and you can always trust people, but you should always know for yourself. I think that's really important.
Right. Yeah. So how do you recommend an artist manage expectations, with their team? Or I think even before that, like, how do you manage expectations with your team or with your artists?
What do you mean? Like in a way of like.
Like just getting things done. Like, what is your best workflow when it comes to like working with an artist? Like these things need to get done. How do you break through like the personality and, you know, other things that come with working with an artist?
You just learn people, man. Like that's the part of the growth of a relationship with your artist. You know what I mean? Like that trust is built there. And you manage expectations by honestly just being transparent, like, you know, and being realistic in front. Like, you know, if you're looking at an artist rollout, like an artist finished a project, the first thing they want to do is put it out. During that process, it's really good for you to start creating some of those timelines and sharing them with your artists so they understand how long it's going to take in the process. So that at that point, they're not like, well, you never told me this, or like, yo, why is it taking this long? It's sharing information. Again, it's like the more information you give an artist while you're preparing, and you explain things to them and create understanding on their end, then that to me is managing the expectation of the artist. And even when you do things, like, it's like, again, it's just information. Like if you put out a release and, you know, every artist expects their song to go fucking crazy, it doesn't happen like that. You know what I mean? Like, especially on the start, you gotta be like, yo, you gotta set goals and achieve your goals. And that's also a way to manage expectations. If you exceed your goals, then you exceed the expectation. And if you don't, you know, then it just is what it is. You gotta keep at it. You know what I mean? Like, and you gotta keep hustling, keep the energy positive and keep it going, you know? So, it just comes back to information and how you break that down to the artist and how much of it you give and how much of it you hold or whatever the case may be. But, to me, that's the expectation management aspect.
So, two more questions and then we're going to jump into the Q&A portion.
Mike's here too, by the way. Mike Brinkley jumped in here too, man. What's up, Mike? Yeah.
What's up, man?
Yeah. A fan of his, man.
Where everybody getting a sneak peek. We got Mike coming up after this one. But Gordon, real quick, you know, developing an artist is, you know, hard. I think that's the best way I could describe it. But it's also one of the most important roles when working with new artists. Can you give us some insight into what your formula is, especially, you know, when we think about success and really breaking an artist?
We typically have a process, just a rollout process, a process of building music. I mean, it always starts with the music, you know? So when building an artist, you really have to focus on the songs and the records. Because that's what the audience is going to hear. That's what your consumer is going to hear. So there's heavy focus on that aspect of things. So once the music is right, then it's really building the brand, essentially the artist of brands, and it's growing the brand. It's putting the music out. It's setting the music up for the win. And I say that because, you know, there's a lot of people just throw music out there in the air and they're like, it's going to float. I'm like, no, it's not. it's not going to float. You're going to waste the music. So it's preparation, you know, like, to me, artist building is preparation, for the most part. But it's also, again, it's the artist knowing what they want and wrapping the right people around them to help them achieve those goals and execute those ideas, you know? And then it's like, they execute those ideas and it's our job to make sure those ideas are seen by the world, you know? And that could be via through, you know, marketing, implementation, and it could be through PR, all those things work hand in hand, you know, streaming and things of those natures and getting in front of the right people. And if you're a young manager also, and you're trying to hustle it up, man, like you really got to hustle. Like you got to, like, you don't have, like where we're at in our space now, we have a lot of these contacts, a lot of these things to make the buttons kind of move a little quicker, but it still doesn't matter if the music's not good. You know what I mean? So, but when the music is good, we can move things along a little faster. We can get them in front of the audience a little quicker. But when you're young and you're a young manager in the game, you got to build those networks. Like I spent a lot of time outside in the streets. I spent a lot of time genuinely growing like real relationships. You know what I mean? Like relationships that would work for for the talent, like, and not like in an opportunistic way, but in a way of like genuinely getting to know people and understand, like, and letting them understand who we are, and like, and going outside every day and rooting and pushing for my artists. It's that's a thing. Like, you really are the salesman. You are the CEO of the company. You got to build that company. And the artist side of things, you know, for that, if that side, yeah, they an artist that is blind to what they want, nobody will have direction, you know. So it's working with them to understand that, and again, create plans around creating assets and content and things of that nature, and then getting it into the right people's hands, and staying consistent. You know, that's where the long haul is. Like, it's that's the process. You know, you might get lucky to hit a record, but typically a lot of the times, man, you don't really want that one hit record that is, like, if I had it my choice, would I want like my artists to come out and after the first year, they break off of one record? It's very difficult because you haven't really had a chance to really fully build your fan base and build a grounding. So when that record goes, now you're trying to keep up with it, and it's a difficult race. So patience, time, and one step at a time, you know, builds the artist, and always evolving, you know, always staying true to what it is, but advancing it and making it bigger every single time is key, you know, and then your career gets bigger and bigger, you know, as long as you stick to it.
Dope, man. Love it, yeah, man. Cool. I'm gonna jump into the Q&A section. I think I saw one of these come in a little earlier, and I thought it was important. So a lot of the artists and managers that are on this workshop right now are all from the Midwest, so Milwaukee, Detroit, Cleveland. What's the best way for up-and-coming managers to build a network while being in the Midwest? Do you recommend they move around within the coast, or do you think it's possible to build a network just within the Midwest?
To build a network, that's a tough question, because, you know, I think there's a market in every market, right? There's a network to have, like, you know, like, let's say St. Louis, there wasn't really much going on, like, and I don't know all this, like, to be true, but from my perspective, like, before Nelly and a lot of those guys kind of came around, there wasn't much infrastructure in that city, but it became that. But you also do have to move around. You got to be in these places. Like, I used to, when I was younger, man, I used to, like, get an event list of all these things that were going on in the country. And although it was I couldn't afford to go to all of them. And I had to work. And mind you always got to have a means to an end. You got to have, like, don't be afraid to go get a job, you know, while you're hustling it. You know what I mean? Like, you got to bring money in, or, you know, some people do it. They get a credit card and they go crazy with it. And then that's how they build their business. But that's not always possible for, you know, a lot of kids and a lot of people to get credit like that. So, you know, to have a job is okay, but then to use money and, like, take time to get to these locations and to, you know, and to network and to build, be present. Being present a lot of the times, like, I had to move to New York. Like, I was in Oakland, and Oakland was a cool city. There wasn't much infrastructure at the time, with some context I could have. But, you know, when I moved to New York, that's when I was able to really hustle, and there was just more available. There's more to be around and to get around and more people to network with, you know. So not saying it's impossible, but you got to be willing to step outside your comfort zone and to go to different places and to meet different people.
There's a lot of questions coming in of, like, and I mean, we get these pretty often, so I'm curious on your take on it. You know, when it comes to money, right? Yeah. And, you know, this is what I'll just read with the first one that came up. How do you deal with paying people on your team when cash flow is tight and unpredictable?
Look, man, like, I say this, and I've had this with artists that don't want to pay their team. I've had it with team. Like, I wasn't making no money when I was working with these artists in the beginning, man. Like, this is a hustle, bro. You got to get people around you that understand the end goal and are down to ride with you for the end goal. And that's just real. Like, you know what I mean? If they're looking for a quick paycheck, then they got to go get a job. This ain't for them. You know what I mean? Like, there is no such thing. And I you know, there's people that, you know, unless you, you know, were born with a silver spoon in your mouth, you got bread just, like, kind of laying around, and you could take care of a team like that. In the beginning, man, you need to find some really good people that are good at the job. Like, not every dope creative comes, you know, is discovered yet. You know, you got to look for these people and you got to find the right creators. Like, you know, a Virgil didn't become a Virgil overnight. You know, he started working somewhere. You got to find those guys. You got to find the guys that are really dope that also want to grow and want to build a mission, you know, build for themselves. And you got to open it up and you guys got to hustle. Like I tell my friend all the time, he's actually Doja's photographer. I've worked with him across the board with a lot of my artists for like 6 or 7 years now. When we first came, I was like, bro, we don't have any money to pay you right now. But if you want to jump in and get involved in this, like, you know, this is what it is. As we get money, we'll pay you. But you know, everybody makes money. Like as we get money, everybody will make some, but you gotta be down for the cause. And you know, he's been riding with me for like 7 years now. And now he's making a killing. He's doing like, you know, he has covered billboards all over the place. Like, and I'm super happy because that's him eating, but there's a lot of people that are around us that stayed with us and believed in a dream. And, you know, 7 years later, you know, with some loyalty and some hard work, you know, they're in better positions for themselves. And that's really the goal. So nah, man, like if people ask for money and they like, and they're trying to hit you for bread, go find somebody else that believes in the goal.
I think we have time for two questions real quick, maybe just one. I think this one's great. It's coming from an artist. As an artist, I just love making music and it's about the music for me. Yeah. What do you expect artists to say when you ask them, what do they want? Is my vision simply realistic and practical? That kind of makes sense. I don't know if you...
Not really.
I think what they're trying to say is like, can their vision of just like wanting to make music be an appropriate answer when someone like yourself were to ask them?
I mean, nah, not really. Like, what do you want to do with your music? You know, where you want to go with your music? Like, what do you see for your music? Like, what do you see creatively? Like, you have a vision for like how you want people to see your music, like as far as videos and like how you want to present yourself. Like, what's your brand? Like, you know, like you got to think of those things. Like making great music, unless you just want to be a songwriter. If you want to be a songwriter, yeah, you can just make great music. Yeah. If you write really great music or if you produce really great music, you still have a goal for yourself. But if you just do that, then that's fine. Then that, you know, that's, you know, you don't need to be an artist. But if you need to be an artist, there has to be a full package. You got to think about those things. You know, you got to look at some of your favorite artists, not take their ideas or take what they are, or who they are, because you got to say to yourself, but you got to like, use those as an example. Like Doja knows exactly who she is. Like, she knows creatively exactly what she wants. She writes her own treatments out. Like she does a lot of things herself. She sees it. She has a vision for it. You got to have a vision for who you are as an artist and you know, and what people are going to buy into. Just plain and simple, you know?
All right. Last question real quick is what tools and information/resources did you use when you were starting your career as an artist manager? I think that's pretty straightforward.
What tools and resources?
Yeah.
The internet and the city that I was in and just trying to get close to as much of the action as possible, you know, but I would use the internet to do so. You know, I'd use the internet to find the right people, find the right team, the right directors, the right everybody, you know. Like I found a lot, like when we were shooting videos at an early place, man, like we didn't have money to shoot videos, but we had cool, we found great creatives that were at a younger space that were down to shoot some really cool videos. So they would do it, you know, and to reach out. Like it was always, it was outreach consistently. Like, you know, if you want to get something, you got to ask for it. And you got to put yourself in position. But also I use this, and I say this to a lot of people, and I say it to people that are established and not established, you got to build value with people. Like when you're networking with people, come with value. Don't come with just your hands open, because that won't get you nowhere. Because if you can't do something for someone, then you are worthless to that person, and essentially, and they don't need to help you. So always be prepared to create value somewhere with someone, and that's the right way to network, because it's an even exchange. Like they give you opportunity, you create value for them that eventually will create either financial, some, you know, benefit for them or some type of benefit for them. But you can't go to people and you know, with your hands open and nothing to offer. Like that doesn't work.
And amen.
Yeah.
Thanks, man. Well, thank you again, man. I appreciate you taking the time. Sure. You dropped some gems for everyone. You know, if people are interested in just following your journey, what's the best way to, you know, keep up with you?
I'm on social media, G_UNTLD. and that's about it, man. I kind of stay on the radar for the most part, but you know, I'm active there. So, you know, if you want to get a hold of me, or like you have, you know, questions or anything like that, you hit me there.
Cool. Appreciate it, man. Thanks again for taking the time. We'll stay in touch, man. Appreciate it.
For sure, man. Y'all in for a treat with Mike, man. So you guys enjoy that. Appreciate everybody for listening in, man.
For sure. All right. Well, I'm gonna pass it off to Sway from Detroit. Sway, you there?
Yes, I am.
Love it. Yo, I wish we could make some noise for G. There we go. We need sound effects. We need burp, 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 burp.
Yeah, we need the air horns for sure. We should get that for next workshop for sure. Okay. Hey, everybody. I was not on at the top of the call when Meg introduced me. Had some technical difficulties, per usual. But I'm here now. Thank you all for pulling up. We are going to get into introducing the Detroit artists who are part of this year's 2021 Motown Accelerator program. I'm going to share my screen and get into the videos. Give me like 2 seconds to do that.
In the meantime, everyone, make sure you guys go to Instagram.com. I said Instagram.com like it's not an app, right? But go to your app. Go and follow Jordan. Go make sure you guys give him a follow. It's super inspiring to see that every day. But yeah, all right, I'm out of here.
All right. Meg, can you see my screen? Am I sharing? I'm good? All right.
You're all good.
All right, here we go.
My name is Jonah. I'm from Detroit, Michigan. I'm an alternative R&B and hip hop artist. My musical process, I would say, is very organic. I think it's all about how I feel. Some days I might feel like spending 10, 12 hours on a song and really, you know, like writing an essay. And sometimes it's just about going in there and freestyling and how I feel. My trip to LA, it was LA, so it was definitely fun, but I think I had a lot of growth individually as an artist. Just the whole pace, that they have in LA, is everything is really fast, and it's about making high quality stuff real fast. And I think it kind of just, like, as an artist, took me to a whole nother level. So that was probably, at this point, my favorite part of the whole thing.
So that was Jonah. All right, I'm gonna go back to back and introduce you all as well to our next artist. 1 second. Oh wait, am I doing it right? Give me 1 second, y'all. Hold on, I don't wanna do it wrong. There we go.
Dang it, I look directly into the camera. You can just keep it going, all right? Hello, my name is Caleb Shoemake. I'm from Detroit, Michigan. I'm 24 years old, and I make alternative R&B music that encourages the listener to feel their emotions. I grew up as a PK, and then I also grew up in a house that was very emotionally aware. And so you hear that in my lyrics. I wanted to write music and develop myself more as an artist. I learned about the Motown Accelerator program.
Yo, I just got a text that said we lost audio. Why? We should not have. Don't worry. You'll be able to watch those videos in their entirety on our Instagram page tomorrow. We'll make sure we put them up. I'm sorry you lost audio. Listen, y'all. Mercury is in the microwave, so it's just a whole lot happening right now. Anyways, I'm going to go ahead and bring up our next guest. We're moving on in our workshop program. He's already here, ladies and gentlemen. Mike Brinkley. This is such a pleasure for me. I've been knowing Mike since, I don't need to tell my age, a while. And I met him through a song that I did with one of his artists that he was managing at the time. And he doesn't know it. This is his first time hearing it, but he has really, truly inspired me and like motivated me throughout the years, even though I've come away from artistry and moved into like the executive side of music, I guess, you know, it's still very much so a mentorship type of relationship. So Mike, I appreciate you so much. You maybe didn't know that. Thank you so much for being here tonight.
Thank you. I mean, pleasure to be on here.
All right. So, I mean, your resume is long. So I could start way at the beginning or I could start more recently, but I think the best way that I could sum it up is that you've been in artist management for a good chunk of years now. You know what you're doing. You've helped a lot of artists put themselves on the map and like actualize their dreams. So I will let you take it from here and share with us what you'd like for us to know.
Okay, I mean, I could start. I've been in artist management, I would say, you know, maybe 20 plus now. I've worked with so many guys in just different areas of their career. I mean, from, as Wade mentioned, I worked with Big Sean for a long time. I have, for some reason, I tend to work with a lot of Detroit artists. So, you know, it's been, you know, a pleasure, you know, just, you know, working with guys, Detroit, Michigan, Midwest. Some of which are, like I said, Big Sean, Dej Loaf, Key Wayne, John Connor, you know, it's a wide range of Midwest guys. I've worked with Stally. You know, list goes on and on. Where would you like, go ahead.
You love Detroit. I'm not mad at that. So does President Barack Obama. Everybody loves Detroit. Yes. All right, let's get into it. So I have a lot of questions for you tonight. I sent them to you in advance. I may not get through all of them. And I also just wanted to let the conversation flow naturally, but I did have some prepared that I think our audience, predominantly artists, managers from the Midwest, I think they would definitely want to hear some of your responses to these things. So let's, looking at your career over the last couple of decades, can you for us define, you know, we're going to start out talking about you, like what were maybe two or three major decisions that got you to here or that you feel like, you know, got you to the level of success that you were hoping for?
Two major decisions. I think the best way to look at it is one is understanding your artist, right? I mean, you have to really have a scope of who that artist is, what their work ethic is, and how you guys collectively can move to achieve that goal. I can go, you want me to go into like a specific instance or?
Yeah, I mean, you could give us some details as much as you can, yeah.
Something specific. For instance, okay, I go to a Big Sean story. So, working with Big Sean, he's a super talented guy and just a positive human being, right? And an avid sneakerhead. So there was a point where, you know, Adidas wasn't always that cool brand, you know, Sean was a Nike guy, Jordan guy. And there was an opportunity to do business with Adidas. And, you know, it took some arm twisting, it took some educating and just overall is figuring out the best possible deal, but it ended up working out. And I mean, if we go back, Sean was kind of one of the first artists to partner with Adidas, which was then led to, you know, Pusha T, Teyana Taylor, and moving forward, Kanye. So Sean was the one that kind of did that initial and it kind of opened that door for so much more.
Yeah. And so that was one. What's another one?
Um,
So you definitely had to do some heavy persuasion for your artists to get them to see your point of view. I had to do that every time.
Absolutely. It is really just, you know, again, getting to understand that the bigger picture, that just that, that there's always, you know, a longer and a bigger play to everything. You have to be strategic. You have to, you know, really decide what your end goal is. You know?
So. Absolutely. So our topic for the workshop is From the Ground Up, Building an Artist Team That Wins. Mm-hmm. Let's get into that. When you were at the beginning of these artists' careers, you know, and you meet someone who's immensely talented, how did you help them build out their framework? From personal experience, just so everybody knows on the call, I'm in this director role now with Motown Accelerator, but I'm very much right somewhere very deep down an artist. And I had a song with Big Sean back in 2010, and that's when I first met Mike. And one of the things that I was really, really impressed with was that it just seems like Sean had like a family of people around him that were all very dedicated to seeing him blow up, you know? And I just was like, man, how did he find these people? How did they know what to do? You know, because we would do some spot dates together and perform our song. And I'm like, he has like five guys with him that are all doing something specific. So Mike, when an artist is very new, like what are the people that they should be looking for? And you know, how do you divide responsibilities?
It comes down to the definition of team. I mean, you want to be able to find, you know, people that are going to play their different positions. So it's again, it's understanding who at the time what is needed. So you have to really assess for the goal you're trying to reach, you know, what pieces, what people do I need to get here? So, I mean, and everyone may not be skilled. Like, you know, there'll be development, there'll be learning, education. So, you know, again, assessing what's needed. You know, it's not a cookie cutter. Every artist may need different things. Like, you know, if an artist is, you know, self-motivated and, you know, is great in the studio, you may need someone to help with, you know, kind of just like now magnifying or marketing or, so just kind of assessing first and then building around that. But, you know, again, finding people that wants to, one, understand the role, be great at the role, and, you know, and all work for that common goal. But again, it starts with, you know, identifying and assessing what's needed for that individual.
My coworker mentioned something on the last conversation, like knowing, I lost my train of thought, but anyways, I'm so excited to talk to everybody. How do you, you know, figure out when you're looking for an artist to work with, like who has that it thing that you're like, okay, this is someone who I could see myself devoting my time and attention to?
Initially for me, there has to be a certain level of talent, a certain level of you know, a certain skill set, right? So take talent aside, there still has to be a certain work ethic, a certain understanding of what this person wants, you know, wants to get to. You know, and couple that with, you know, being able to, is this person willing to put the time and energy and work into it? So, you know, it's a few things. Like I said, you know, talent has to be there, but also the ability and the need to work and get that job done. And me in particular, I really, you know, prefer to work with people that are just are genuinely good people, good humans. You know, you may come across someone that's super talented or have, you know, a record that's going, but, you know, some of these other traits are not there.
No, I get that. I think we don't talk about that too much in music when we say, you know, just gotta work hard and you just gotta, you know, not stop and keep going. There is that little piece about talent. Like the music does need to be good. Artists do need to take their time developing and finding their sound and then press and go, you know, once the music is really, really good.
Absolutely.
Something we don't talk about, but we should talk about more. So there's a lot of different interpretation of what a manager is and what a manager does for an artist when we're talking about teams. What, from your perspective, you know, should a manager be doing for an artist once the music is good?
I mean, I would say that the main definition of a manager is to help, you know, facilitate an artist to, you know, to get to their goal, you know, and that goal may be, you know, just furthering their music career. So, you know, you have artists that may, you know, just be content with, you know, living off of their music. You have artists that just, you know, may want a certain level of fame. You have artists that may want, you know, monetary goals. So it's understanding, you know, or some may want all of the above. It's understanding what's the goal you're trying to get to. And then again, being, you know, realistic on how to achieve that and being able to, again, here's the steps we need to take to make it down that path. So it's really facilitating.
Yeah. Can you maybe give us some insights or an example of maybe like your best experience, you know, in all of the years in working with an artist? You don't have to say names, but, you know, like, what were some of the highlights of working with that really great artist? Like, what were their characteristics?
For me, I really like, you know, I've had the pleasure to work with established artists and, you know, but it's really still, it's still, my greatest take is to work with, to develop something from the ground up, right? From the initial stages. So I really like the point of, you know, maybe, you know, working with someone in the studio to, you know, figuring out the game plan and seeing them grow and, you know, go from, you know, trying to figure out songs in the studio to that point where they may have hear the song for the first time on the radio and, or get in front of a crowd for a sold out show, or, you know, I enjoy those moments the most, you know, taking something from the beginning and watching them develop as a person and as an artist. So.
Yeah, that is really cool. So speaking of, you know, like doing that all from the ground up, when you get these people together, like you have your artist, let's say you meet this amazingly talented artist tomorrow, you know, and they have the talent, they're very motivated in the studio, they need help with marketing and, you know, social media, but, you know, as we said on, you know, in the last conversation, they don't have a budget to pay people yet. What's the very next step? Because you can't do it all, right? They can't do it all. What's the very next step and very next person that you reach out to?
As far as team building, I would say, you know, the goal is to get fans. So, you know, a lot of artists think that, okay, you know, I need to find a label or find a manager. I think the premise should be, you know, how can I turn these two fans into four, the four into eight. So it's figuring out how to interact and touch as many people as I can. And sometimes that starts with, like, it's the basics, basic fundamentals, family, friends, and that is still, you know, word of mouth promotion. You know, when you think of going viral is tons of people talking and spreading, like, whoa, I like this thing. So, you know, two turns into four turns into eight, like, that should still be the premise. You can't rule out the fundamentals, you know, and once you start doing that, you know, people will start to pay attention, and then you could add on pieces as needed, you know. You know, you could get to the PR phase, you would get to a marketing person, but you have to have some type of a base to add those things for it to make sense and really be, you know, to serve its purpose.
And so we're clear, what are you saying is that base before you start pulling in people?
You have to have, at least it has to be an appetite for it. You have to have some type of audience. So if you're an artist and you don't have your close family and friends paying attention to your music, how can you get strangers? So you have to start somewhere.
Yeah, that I think that might be a nugget takeaway from the whole night. If you can't, you know, if your close family and friends aren't listening, then you need to figure something out to get everybody else to start paying attention. I totally agree. When you're pulling people in, let's say, I don't know, maybe, you know, because we do this with artists, we are working with people from around the industry, or we might be working with people that the artist has known for some time. Like, are there any qualities that you look for, or red flags? It's a big thing on Instagram right now, the red flags memes. Is there anything where you're like, okay, that's somebody we want to bring in, that's somebody we don't want to bring in?
As far as artists?
As far as the artist team, yeah, like obviously there's things to work about, but think about, but like self-awareness is something we wonder about a lot, you know, like, does this person know who they are, you know? Do you necessarily have to work with somebody who had a track record, or what if they just are really passionate, you know?
No, the main thing is passion is important, but the willingness to learn and do the actual, you know, the role, you know, and it may be different things, you know. Another big part is someone that's again, willing to learn and not scared to ask questions. If you're in a position, you know, and even if you're new and you're trying to, you know, get into management and or get into A&R or any aspect of music, you know, you're learning. So always try to ask questions. Like, don't be scared to just try to figure it out on your own. Ask all the questions you can. Because when you don't, that could be very dangerous and detrimental to an artist or anyone you're working with. Like, you have to be able to, and it's okay to not know everything. I learn every day. That's all a part of it. So, you know, ask questions and, you know, and try to be in that position to always learn. Yeah. So that's what I look for. I look for people that's willing to, again, put the work in and be willing to understand and try to get to that next goal.
Definitely. One of, you know, you say put the work in, that makes me think of, you know, the artists that we work with in the program and just artists in general, myself included, you know, years ago. Artist development. For a manager, I feel like when you guys come in, you might get lucky and find an artist that's just like already moving up, but maybe you don't. Maybe you find somebody, like you said, who has just this great amount of talent, but very much so a diamond in the rough. What are some of your insights or best practices or just things that you do in the areas of artist development?
There's so many facets to artist development. One is, you know, again, you know, you can start with studio, right? Studio etiquette, understanding how to, you know, again, work in the studio. That's one phase. Working in the studio, knowing and understanding how to record, you know, again, you know, getting your vocals down. That's one part of it, right? So you have some people that may be, you know, not so great at that, but they may be great at live. You have some people that may be, you know, you put them in the studio, they'll make 100 songs, but, you know, when it's time to interact with a human being or someone, you know, doing an interview, it's a little awkward. So you have to, you know, figure out how to develop that part of it. You know, you have people that may be good at those two things, but performing is not their strong suit. So again, it's like how to make sure on all these grounds you're able to be a total artist. Because again, you know, studio is just one part. You have to speak to people. Yeah. And, you know, music is changing, you know, decade after decade, you know, we went from records, tapes, CDs to streaming. But one thing that will never change, whether you go 100 years further, is the performance. People will always go to see someone perform and be entertained. So that has to be a priority for all artists. So, you know.
Yeah. What does it take time-wise? This is something that, again, this was mentioned in the last conversation. We see the artists like, boom, they're on all the playlists. The song is on the radio. We love it, right? Mm-hmm. But, and it's different for every artist, but in, you know, like if you could maybe give a case study on, I met this artist in this year, And then for the first year, we worked on this. And then the next 6 months, we did this. Like, is there anything like that you can speak about?
I mean, it's different now. Because, I mean, years ago, you know, it just, things have changed so much. So if you think of, you know, I don't know the age of the average age of, you know, people on here, but if you think of the, you know, the times when artists were selling CDs, right? I mean, it's a different approach. You had to, you know, you had to get your audience, you know, attention in a different way. You were trying to get your audience to, okay, hey, I have this CD. It's 15, 20 bucks. You know, everybody go get it now. And, you know, whether, you know, they were able to play it right away, some people just supported and got your CD. Now with streaming, you're not competing for your fans' money, right?
Right.
Money is irrelevant. You're competing for your fans' time. So your approach is to, you know, hey, here's my music. You know, I want you to check it out, but also listen to it over and over and over. So it's, you see, a time you're trying to get from your fans. I mean, the average person may not listen to a song, you know, 150 times. It may take them a month or two, but that's what equates to one sale. So, you know, you, as an artist, you want to be able to figure out how to keep engaged with your fans to make sure they keep listening and are, you know, will revisit your music.
Absolutely. That's not easy to figure out.
It's not, but I mean, again, that part of it is, like, again, that's where content comes into play. That's where, you know, engaging via the internet comes into play, which was not always there so many years ago. And again, you can touch people all over the world, you know, in one swoop now. So it's about utilizing these things and still being true to yourself as an artist, but, you know, being able to, you know, again, communicate with fans.
Thank you for that. Something you mentioned made me think of this, like when you have an artist and let's say management is not on board yet, you know, and it's just somebody that's super passionate about their music, trying to put something together, you know, what are some things that that person can do in this new leadership role to make sure that things flow smoothly as far as, you know, we are Motown Accelerator and we're under the Generator Music umbrella. My Google Calendar is full of meetings every week, you know, and it's like, oh, meetings. But at the same time, this is what, you know, this is what keeps us accountable. This is what keeps us checking in every week. You know, it's necessary. So as an artist steering a ship, an entrepreneur of a team, like what are some of the things that they can do to keep people excited and motivated and down for the cause, basically?
Again, this, you know, you have to appreciate your team, number one, you know, so, you know, especially, you know, if you look at management, right? Management may be one of the only jobs that, you know, you may put in 6 months, a year, 8, 12, 14 hours a day of working and see zero revenue, right? So if, as an artist, if you have a group of people that's dedicating this time, energy, and focus to you, you know, you have to be appreciative, you know, because you never know how long it will take for you guys to even generate anything from this work that's being put in. So you know, again, you know, you have positive people that's, you know, trying to all help you get to your dream goal, you know. There has to be, you know, a level of appreciation and, you know, and tolerance and understanding. But, you know, again, your people, sometimes they, you know, you may bump heads, but, you know, people are working to help, you know, to help the artists. And it may not be, you know, anything that comes from it for them. So, you know.
Yeah. It just has to be find those right people. So I want to back up. I want everybody who leaves here tonight. I mean, this is something that you can find on Google, but I want to hear from you. I want everyone who comes here, who leaves here tonight to know, or at least have some idea, if they don't have a team, you know, how do they build this team? So this is an artist, for example, that is in the studio right now recording, mm-hmm. maybe put out a single, not a lot of traction, but there is that talent there. There is that passion there. you know, maybe 3 or 4 or 5 key people that they should have around them at the very beginning. I remember getting these constant contact emails, and I'm like, man, how did they know to send those? Like, I was not even hip, you know, those years ago to those emails. I'm like, how did they know to do that? So very, very basic, very fundamental. Like, everybody leaving this workshop tonight knows that, all right, I'm an artist. I'm doing this by myself. I'm independent. I need to have this 3 to 5 key people in place to help me get this off the ground.
Right. I mean, I would say, you know, you would need someone that at least that could help you with this administrative thing, right? So, I mean, again, you know, responding to emails or just making sure you stay in communication, you know, and deal with things in a timely fashion, right? I've seen so many artists that, you know, that may, you know, even if they're doing a small venue show, like, or a showcase, right? You know, maybe 50, 100 people in a showcase, and they're performing and trying to gain new fans. Someone should be there in the audience, you know, people that's responding positively, hey, let me get your number, let me get your email, you know, let me stay in contact with you. So while this person is on stage, they can't do that, but someone on their team should be able to, you know, work the crowd and get contact information. And that way you can always, you know, hey, I got more music coming. You did like what I did. Like, you have to have this communication and build that network. And that's building a fan base, getting contact information with people that are, you know, appreciating your craft. So as simple as it sounds, it helps to grow what you're trying to build.
Yeah. So admin, street team. Yeah. What about, you know, now in this new social media space, what are some of the roles that you're seeing emerge?
I mean, it should be someone that's like, you know, and is more common sense. Hey, you know, if you're trying to be an artist, that means you have a public persona. Have someone on your team that, okay, look, hey, you can't say that. Clean this up. Like, you know, or, you know, just, you know, be mindful of what you put out there. If you, you know, you really want to, you know, you really want to grow and be successful. So, you know.
And then one more question for you before we move into the Q&A. We have an amazing therapist who works with our program for the artists in Detroit and Milwaukee. We meet with her biweekly and talk about, you know, the challenges that come up for modern artists in a modern world trying to put out music. And something she said, talked about earlier during our mental health check-in was, you know, resolving conflict within a group. Can you speak to that? Like, over the years, like, what has been some great things that you've, some great leadership characteristics that you've seen from artists who, like, know how to keep the drama to a minimum? And maybe, like, some worst case scenarios where it's like things, like, quickly got off the rail.
Let me see. I would like to say probably by nature, most creative people, most artists are non-confrontational, right? So there's always going to be someone on the team to have to, you know, be that buffer or, you know, kind of sometimes, you know, take the hit. So it's understanding a situation, right? There's, you know, being an artist or being a creative, you know, you have to separate, you know, sometimes, you know, your personal from your art, and understand that, you know, you can't react to things in a certain way, especially in the time now of social media. You know, you always have to think twice, 3 times before just blowing up, because anything can derail what you're trying to build at this time. So, I mean, again, that's going to come down to your team, you know, helping to diffuse, you know, just helping overall, because, you know, it's just really a time now where you have to pay attention and really be conscious of, you know, how you move and how you react to things. You know, the ripple effect could, you know, it's could be never ending.
Yeah. Absolutely. I used to say too much on the internet once upon a time. I had to check myself, though. There was no team. Mm-hmm. But all right, let's get into our Q&A. I'm going to try and scroll back as far as I can. This is not a question. I think this is just funny. Somebody said, Nick Varsity said, what up, Bill? Says, so much talent in Detroit. I met my artist in my lift. He performed for me, and that was it for me. I love that. I love that story that they met during a lift drive. Okay, here's a question for you. How do you know when to pass on an artist, even if they're naturally gifted and they've done some work? I guess that might be a manager asking that.
For me, it's really, it may come down to you know, an artist's overall demeanor, personality, or just, you know, where they are, you know, and, you know, just with, you know, overall in their life. Like, you know, if someone's day-to-day life is not in order, and, you know, there's issues there, you know, you can't really help them progress as a creative if their life is not in order. A lot of times people take on managers as this person that's just gonna, you know, just save them from whatever's going on, but it's really to facilitate that dream and you guys work together to accomplish things. So for me, if I see someone whose life is just in disarray and, you know, just so much chaos going on, regardless of what of the potential of the music, I tend to stay away.
That's a very real question and a very real response. And that kind of circles back to, you know, us having that mental health check-in and us having a therapist that's embedded into the program. That is something that I'd encourage all artists to explore and consider, like having somebody you can talk to in a safe space that where, you know, so that you can let all of that out in that space. And then when you come to your music and when you come to your team, you're not coming with all that baggage, you know, just the talent, just the ethic, the work ethic, just those things. So I'm glad we touched on that. Is there a resource that could help define what an artist team is or should be? I always joke that our workshops are, you know, the things that you can't find on Google. So I think that you've given us a lot of gems, but have you come across any like articles or books or platforms that, you know, really speak to this topic?
I mean, especially now there's so many things. It's again, it just comes down to research. You know, again, what you guys are doing with this Motown Accelerator. I mean, you know, it's a great starting point. Being able to share ideas and get knowledge with like-minded creatives, it starts there. Like, you know, I'm sure there's other programs, you know, big and small, you just have to really take the time to look.
Yeah.
Don't rule out the fundamentals. Like, again, it's communicating with people, networking, you know, and researching, so, you know. I know a few programs, you know, again, the Motown Accelerator, but it's like, especially now, day of the internet, like you can search for and find pretty much everything.
Yeah. Here's a good question. Thank you for that. That's another key takeaway, is going back to the fundamentals and the best and the, like, the basics. Here's another good one. How can someone in a managerial role keep things moving at a steady pace and avoid becoming stagnant? I am trying to get a couple of both of our Motown Accelerator artists to wrap up their EPs as we approach the holidays. Man, I don't want to nag, but at the same time, it's like, come on, y'all. After November 15th, nobody's working. You know, we're not at the pace that we are now. So any tips in that area?
I mean, setting realistic deadlines and goals and executing, like, you know, having an idea will just be that until you execute. So, you know, again, it's getting to that finish line, always completing that task and setting up that next task. You know, you can't, you know, rely on just, you know, getting to that first base. You have to keep going, you know, especially as a new and developing artist or a new as developing manager. Like, what are you trying to get to? And how many steps do we need to get there? And if you ever do daily check-ins, weekly check-ins, did we accomplish what we set out to accomplish today, this week, this month, you know? So.
I think that's key. So I had a conversation with somebody recently and they were saying, you know, the weekly check-ins really help. They were in a totally different professional space, but that is a great way, I think, to keep your team all on the same page, keep everybody motivated, let them know what you're working on, daily or weekly, but definitely some type of regular check-in. There was another good one in here. Here's another one. You run across a lot of talented artists. I know you do. How do you resist the urge to want to work with everybody?
There's only 24 hours in a day.
Easy. That's an easy answer.
Yeah,
that's it. There's only 24 hours in a day, y'all. You can't do anything. You have to pick and choose. And then there's so much. We could just talk forever about this. But I guess my main question and my main takeaways for people who are here, who put up to this workshop, it's not easy, you know, finding the people that you want to find. Sometimes your cousin, you know, is good at something, or you see that she's got a really professional thing about her, like I should employ her. But then sometimes you just don't see the people around you. What is the main takeaway when we're talking about building a team that works where everybody can eventually get paid and be happy in their roles? You know, like, what is the main thing that an artist should be trying to do to make that happen, whatever stage they're at right now? Maybe they have a team, but things are like all crazy with the people on the team. Like, what's the main takeaway, a good nugget for everybody trying to build something that wins?
The first thing I would say is finding the right people with the right characteristics for the roles, right? And don't be scared to say no to someone. You may come across someone, let me do this and let me do that for you, but they're not good at it. Don't be scared to say no, thank you. And then on the flip side of that is, you know, as an artist, you know, that you're trying to build a team, you know, you may have to barter. If you're a singer-songwriter and you come across a guy that's a musician or a producer, you know, you may be like, look, I need some beats from you, you know. Maybe you need some hooks from me. Maybe you need some writing from me. Like, don't, you know, be of value to that other person you're trying to bring on, you know? You just never know. Like, everything counts. Like, you know, you never know what this other person may be able to help with. So.
I got distracted by the chat. But no, it's so much to manage at once. No, but that's amazing. I think, again, like you said, like knowing the right people and not being afraid to say no, pulling people in when you're like, when you have questions, asking questions, having a great work ethic, like all of those things are ideal for an artist. And I would just encourage everybody, you know, we're in the fourth quarter now. In the music business, like, things kind of slow down at this time. This is a great time, Mike, to do what?
Work on your craft, like work on a plan, work on, you know, deciding what you're really trying to achieve from your music, from your creative skills. Like, and there's no rush, you know. You can take your time and go within your means, you know. If you're only able to go into the studio once a month, you know, figure out the best way to maximize on that, you know. If you're only able to, if you have to just, you know, probably grab a mic and record on your laptop to figure out the best way to make it sound as good as you can. Like, you know, work within your means and definitely be smart about, you know, how you can, you know, build and kind of get to your goals. So, you know.
Cool. I think my last question, this just came to me when you were speaking. If things are, you know, let's say an artist puts out a single and they put out another single and it just doesn't hit those streaming goals that everybody was hoping for, but it is good music. Everybody on the team recognizes this is heat, but it just didn't catch. How can an artist keep their team around them motivated, you know, inspired to stay on and continue working with them, even when, you know, things don't go as planned?
I mean, that's going to be the majority of the time. You know, there's, you know, you can't even calculate how many songs I released on a daily basis. So again, it's setting, you know, realistic goals and knowing that, you know, you have to continue to push and you know, and put your music in front of people. So again, don't go past the basic stuff of, hey, you know, I met this person and hit check out my music. You have to constantly promote yourself, and your team should be promoting you as well. So your mission should be to, you know, again, everyone that you come across, check this music out. Because again, you're competing with people's time. You want, you know, so, you know, people have whatever service they listen to music on. It's not about getting them to buy it. It's about that, about you getting that 3-4 minutes from them. So you have to be creative with that. You have to be, you know, persistent with that, you know? And again, it starts with family, friends, and that general word of mouth, you know? It's that constant push, you know? And there's so many ways to you know, get people to check your music out, whether, you know, you may have, you know, a QR code here, you know, listen to this, you know, pull this up, like, you know, again, Don't go past the basic fundamentals. That's still the premise of, you know, promoting. Yeah.
Dope. Well, thank you, Mike. This is amazing. I'm gonna pass it back over to Mag. If he's still in there, he should be there.
And I'm fine. If there's any other questions in the comments, you know.
I know, right? I think we. Well, I mean, we're going to keep it to time. So, but what's the best way if somebody wants to ask you some more questions? What's the best way for them to reach out?
I must say, I'm not very good on socials. I am on, but I'm not on often. I'll give an email that could be shared, you know, with whoever.
Or do you want to just do your Instagram? Is that safer?
Sure.
All right, we can find you at Mike Brinks, right?
Mike_Brinks, yeah.
Mike_Brinks, B-R-I-N-K-S. Mm-hmm. Thank you so much, Mike. Again, this is great. I consider you as one of my mentors. I'm so grateful that I can just text you whenever and get a response. Oh my gosh. Thank you so much for pulling up tonight. I'm sure everybody else feels the same, and I'm gonna pass it back off to Mac.
Thanks again, Mike. Appreciate it.
Thanks for having me, appreciate it.
Awesome. Well, thank you everyone for tuning in to yet another workshop this year. We do have another workshop coming up a month from now. We will be announcing that workshop within the next week or so. But for right now, guys, applications are open for the Milwaukee program and the Motown Accelerator program in Detroit. To apply, go to generatormusic.com/apply. You will be able to get the application for the Motown program and the Milwaukee program. The applications are open for artists and managers. Very similar to how we ran the program this year. The program will be open to 10 artists and 10 managers in each city for a 6-week accelerator that includes a $500 grant. And then from there, we will be selecting 2 artists and 2 managers that will be selected to receive a $25,000 grant for the artists and a $5,000 grant for the managers. Please apply. If you have any questions, both Sway and I have office hours that you can sign up for. We're available. Please sign up. And at a bare minimum, guys, follow us on Instagram at Generator Music and Motown Accelerator on Instagram. That's the best way to stay up to date with anything program related. We will be rolling out the artists and the manager videos this week, so you guys can take a look at everyone who participated in the program. Thanks again for tuning in, and we'll see you guys on the next one.
Wait, I have something to say too.
For sure.
For the applications, like we did this last year, it's unofficial. This is a nugget that you only get during the workshops. We listen to the apps like as they come in early. And if you are unclear on like the best songs that you should be submitting, like message us, hit us up, and then we'll help you like submit the right songs, because we don't do the judging. We pass it off to some other judges, but we can help you, you know, develop the right kind of song to put into the application so that you have a better chance of moving forward in the selection process. So get them in early, get them reviewed early, and get feedback early.
So, cool. Thanks again, everyone, for tuning in, and we'll see you guys soon. Hopefully talk to you guys soon, and we're excited to listen to the music and see the applications come through. Cool. Bye, guys.